Well, who would have thought it, Andover on a Saturday night, line dancing?
Oh yeah, it's going very, very well. Everyone's having a great time.
If you watched the show, if you watched the show last week, you know this is John Ead.
Hello,
come all the way from Canada to perform in Andover. You're on your tour here.
That's right.
That's great.
From here we're going to Woking.
Yeah.
And then actually we're going to be coming back to Andover again.
Yeah.
And I think maybe we might make this a regular thing.
Well, it's a great place, Andover, isn't it? Of course it is. And who's here? None other than Jackie Morris from the Andover Leisure Centre. Hi.
Hello there, Alan. How are you doing?
I'm great. How are you doing?
Great. I'm really, really pleased with the response here tonight.
This is amazing, Andover on a Saturday night.
People are exercising on a Saturday night, Alan. Do you realise this is exercise?
Is it exercise?
Oh, it is.
Is it?
Definitely.
So what's the difference between exercise and dancing, I suppose?
There's no difference.
There's not,
they're moving. At the end of the day, they're moving, and that's great. Not sitting too still, drinking too many beers, but it's good. It's really good for Andover on a Saturday night.
Johnny, I never saw you as a fitness instructor.
Oh, yes. Well, you know, I do try to do my part for participation, you know, but dancing at the same time, not only exercising, but you're having fun.
Yeah.
And fun is the name of the game right here.
So you're going to be doing a set in a minute, right?
Yeah, we're going to be going up and playing some country music and hope that we're going to really, you know, light the place up.
What a turnout. That is great, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, it is. It's great. And I think that we carry this on a little bit more. I think that the next time it'll get bigger than this. And then before long, you won't be able to squeeze them in here.
Yep. Now, can you do this? Can you actually do this?
Well,
now, why don't you and Jackie do the show as I did?
No problem.
Here we go. Ollie, watch these two. Line dancing in Andover on a Saturday night. Take it away, guys.
Away from the sound, and I'm now here with the two main instructors. I've always wanted to know about line dancing, and I believe you're the person to tell me.
Well, one of them. Line dancing first came to England about 12 to 14 years ago. It was a guy called Bob Chappell introduced or brought over two people, Dick and Geneva Mateus.
Right.
And they were big in line dancing in America. They belonged to various organizations, and he put it on at the Pontins festivals. From there it just blossomed, and 96 saw a big boom in the line dance craze. But you must realise there's more to Western dance than just line dancing. It's what the public perceive as the American form of dance. But there's, you know, it's been here 10 to 12 years, so it's not a new thing.
Okay? Right. But how did it actually start in Andover?
I came to a guy, there's a guy in Andover called Chalky White, and he used to run a club called the Big the Big M.
Right.
And I think it was a football field at one time, and it was there, and I saw line dancing there.
Wow, that's amazing. And what's your name?
Diane.
Mrs.
Jackson.
You're Mrs. Jackson. Yes. And do you instruct as well?
Yes, I do. Yes, I'm a qualified D&G instructor.
That's great.
Because Dick and Geneva set up a school. Train instructors, so the terminology would be right, their understanding of the dance form would be right, technique, styling and everything like that. Right. So we don't just teach step, tonight we tended to teach step patterns, but in a class situation we talk more about styling and technique to make our dancers enjoy it more, yeah?
And so do you have, what, 3 lessons a week?
5 evenings a week.
That's wonderful. And tonight I've seen a lot of really great dancing, all the couples, I can't believe it.
It's great fun.
It's incredible, yeah. Isn't it? Yeah. What do you think about the result, really, of all the teaching?
That's right. It's very nice to see so many people coming out and having
the enthusiasm
a go.
As well.
It is, yes, yes.
The other thing,
it's a lot of fun,
yeah.
And we keep our lessons fun, you know.
Well, yeah. as you
we
saw.
Always say there's no exams at the end of it.
I think I'm going to try this opportunity tonight and have a go.
It's all about having fun. That's
yeah.
what it's all
Thank
about.
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome. Okay, you're very welcome. No more rules of God,
up this evening of romance from the Andover Leisure Centre, Valentine's Day and all that.
Valentine's
John,
Day.
John, well done. What a great gig.
Well, we had a good time. I don't know. Well, we still are going to have some more, you know. We're going to go out and play a little bit more.
Really?
And I think everyone's warmed up in there. And as far as romantic, well, I think line dancing is healthy.
Healthy.
And it's exercising. And if you're in shape...
Yeah. I can ask Sasha to ask this question because
yes.
she's got romance on the mind. She's in the Comtel magazine this month, so I keep telling you that. So
yes, why not?
Love is in the air, it says, Sasha. What do you think?
Well, I think it's all very wonderful, but I want to know where our next romance stop is going to be.
The next romance stop?
Well, I think I do believe that we're going to be playing in Woking, and then I do believe we're going to be playing in Bristol. And then I think we're taking the show back to Andover here again.
Really?
Yes, we're
really?
Going to be back here. And I think from there we're going Reading, Guildford, and a number of other
places. He's all over the place.
A number of fun places.
Romance is in the air with John Ead.
Darn right.
And what about us tonight?
Well, I'm not quite sure. I think we're going to Enzo's Nightclub in Amesbury, somebody told us.
Nice one,
and
nice one.
It's a really funky sort of... Get on and get with it nightclub.
And why
so,
not? Well, I that's healthy.
No line
too.
Dancing there.
No line dancing. 'Cause our hearts is just staying wild. And our hearts all agree. Wild hearts in the MD Dry Cleaners, the Mel Andover. Now under new management and featuring the revolutionary, environmentally friendly, solvent-free cleaning system, Aquatex. Be friendly to your garments, brighten colours, soften materials, and leave them smelling aquafresh. Literally, all garments can enjoy treatment with Aquatex, including suedes, leathers, and waxed garments. So clean up, smarten up, brighten up at highly competitive prices. Just 48 hours is all we need on any service. ND Dry Cleaners, for the Mall, Bridge Street, Andover.
Share in the community is an oversold expression. However, in the heart of Romsey, there's a drop-in centre that really does care for the community. I'm here with Kim Fielder in the Romsey Cancer Care Society to show that the community really does care. And we're in the Jane Scarth house, and we're stood in front of Jane Scarth's photograph. So Kim, tell us all about Jane, please.
I first met Jane when she was diagnosed with cancer and the future looked not too good for her. And she was referred to me for counselling. And I actually saw Jane on a regular basis for counselling up until the time she died 2 years ago.
And her family then, you were already established, weren't you, as a care society?
Yes.
But then her family got involved with this centre and with helping with the finances of it, yes?
Yes. Shall I tell you what actually happened?
Yes, please.
Yes. As I said, I met Jane. She came to me for counselling. And I was already employed by the Cancer Care Society as their specialist cancer counsellor. So Jane came to see me. After she died, I helped the family through their bereavement. And 1 year later, which was the summer of 95, I thought about setting up a centre in Romsey. So I called together a group of people who'd pledged their support, and we met at my house. And David and Anne Randall, who are Jane's parents, came along to that meeting, and Phil Scarth, Jane's husband, came as well. And when I explained what I wanted to do, to set up a centre in Romsey, they pledged their support in Jane's memory. And so it seemed fitting that because they pledged their support that we should call it the Jane Scarth House, which fitted together with the Cancer Care Society.
And Jane and her family are Romsey people, so this is the community putting something back into the community again, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Yes. They're very well known in Romsey. Jane worked in Romsey, and the family have lived in Romsey all their life, and Jane did too.
Jane Scarth House is situated in the 100 in Romsey. Mm. It's open 6 days a week. What do people gain from it? Why is it here? And what do cancer patients and their families get from the centre?
It's what I wanted. It was a place where people could come and look at up-to-date information, because in my counselling, what I was hearing was that people were going to the library and they were reading information that was out of date. So I wanted a place where they could come and look at literature that was up-to-date and reliable and well-resourced. People cope with cancer in different ways, and some people cope by getting as much information as they can, and they're given some information when they see their doctors and from the hospital, but that doesn't happen every time. And what I wanted was a place where people can read if they want to gain information if they want to, and to know that that information is up to date.
And that's for families, friends, everybody involved around the patient?
Anybody, and in fact student nurses come in, social workers, health visitors.
So the whole sort of circle around cancer, it's a drop-in spot for everybody then?
For anybody, yes. Anybody, everybody, any age. It's the doors open to anyone who wants to know something about cancer.
I'm calling them patients. Do you refer to them as patients or...?
No, right. People really.
People, that's...
People with cancer.
Yes.
Yes, or friends and family. Because often the person who's being treated for cancer is coping, perhaps going to the hospital on a regular basis, and the family around or friends around often feel very helpless and they don't understand what's happening. So they try to inform themselves a bit better. They can come in and have a look at the various radiotherapy, chemotherapy treatments from the literature that we've got here.
It's a drop-in centre. Does that mean that anybody can drop in at any time, or do you work on an appointment principle?
Both. Both. What we have here is an open door where people can come in. If they're shopping in Romsey, they can come in from 10 o'clock to 4:30, 5 days a week, or on a Saturday morning. And we have people here, volunteers, who are trained in listening skills to actually make them a cup of coffee, sit down, they can read the books, or they may come from... for complementary therapies, or they may make a one-to-one appointment to see me for professional counselling, which is totally free.
Something you said when we spoke earlier was that it was a place for people to come to be happy or unhappy.
Yes.
Can you just explain that a little better to me?
Well, some people, we've had people who've been shopping at the supermarket next door but one to us, and they've got halfway round the supermarket and been overcome with a panic attack or very upset. They've just run through the door and burst into tears. And that's okay.
That's what you're here for?
Yes.
Well, let's have a look around your centre and see what you can offer and where people can come and relax.
Thank you.
George Baker and Louis Ramsey, local celebrities, are friends of the centre, and I believe they were here for the opening.
Yes, that's right. George officially opened it. This is the photograph of us. And George is our president of the society and is very much involved, in fact. Recently, they did a concert for us at the Plaza Theatre.
Yes, they did, didn't they? It's very good.
It was brilliant. It's a brilliant evening. It really felt like a cancer care evening. Everybody was there for the same reason. It's such a homely place.
So he's not one of these celebrities that just turns up for the opening and disappears?
Definitely not.
No.
No,
no.
Not at all. He's very involved.
Because he's a local man anyway, isn't he? And gets very involved.
That's right. Yes.
But you've got other people involved. I understand when you were getting the place fitted out, the carpet fitter suddenly got lumbered for something a bit dangerous and exciting.
That's right, yes. He was fitting the carpets here and asked how we were going to raise money to keep the centre going. And there he said, where's the money coming from? I said, it was a good point. It's a step in faith. And he told me that he raced in rigid inflatables, like indoor life raft, lifeboats.
Inshore lifeboats, yes.
Yes, that's the kind of thing. He said, we'll do something for you. And I never guessed what it was going to be, because it's absolutely phenomenal. They're going to go across the Arctic next June.
So it's the Atlantic and the Arctic via Greenland and...
Yes. What they're doing, they're going from Portsmouth, New Hampshire to Portsmouth, UK. That's 4,100 miles through the ice floes.
In an open boat?
In an open boat. It's really amazing. Very dangerous. That's totally for us.
Now, all the time we're talking, you've got a wide smile. Now, you work very hard at the centre, I know you do, and going out and seeing other people. Mm-hmm. But you get the impression you get a great deal out of it yourself.
Yes, I don't think you could do it. I don't think anyone would do it unless you really felt it was something worthwhile and was of use to somebody.
You've got a patient husband then.
He's part of it. All my friends now see me coming in and run a mile.
Because you get them all involved.
Yes. Fantastic friends and family, a great deal of support.
Have local businesses supported you?
Yes, they have. Mm.
And you've got a story about a 10-year-old girl at a local school.
Yes, that's right. Her name's Charlotte. And it was really sad because her nanny, who cared for her, died. And Charlotte, when she was 10, instead of having birthday presents, actually asked all her friends if they would make a donation to the centre in lieu of a birthday present.
Oh, it's lovely.
And, you know, it's amazing.
But this is a typical story of the people of Romsey, how they've gathered around you.
Yes.
And you're returning that.
Yes, because she was a pupil at Embley Park. And what actually happened is, with the proceeds of the presents, they asked me to go along to the school and speak to the children about cancer. And also for them to make the presentation, check presentation. So, you know, we're involved with very young children as well.
So it really is a two-way thing between the community and the centre then.
Yes.
Kim, we're in your counselling room, which is very homely, very relaxed and friendly. How many people a day do you see in here, or a week do you see in here?
I would see between 20 and 25 people a week, probably 4 to 5 a day, usually about 4 a day, because people have roughly an hour in counselling.
So it's quite a busy schedule. Now, that's got to affect you in some way. If you've had a bad day and you've seen several people who are in a bad way, you've got to be a little down about it. Who talks to you?
Yes, it's true to say that sometimes when things go badly wrong for people, it has some effect. So I go to see somebody called Beatrice in Redhill, and she's super. And she's my supervisor, and she checks me out, and I'm able to share things with her.
And I presume that's the same for your volunteers as well. They can talk to people, and I keep calling it a chat, but it's not really a chat, is it? It's a bit more than that.
It is a bit more than that, yes. I smile when people say a chat, because it cost a great deal of money to train, and it's taken kind of 7 years.
So you've had 7 years of training to know what to say, basically.
Well, it's ongoing. Mm. It's, when you do this kind of work, you're always looking out for new things and courses. And, yes, part of training is part of being a good counsellor.
Now, I keep mentioning talking, but listening's just as important, isn't it? Or if not, more so.
Yes, listening skills are important. That's why we train our volunteers in listening skills and self-awareness. Yes, it is important. And people who come to see me for counselling often have, for the very first time, an hour where they can talk about themselves. Not many of us have that luxury, if you call it a luxury, to actually just talk about yourself, about your feelings, about what's happening in your life for a whole hour.
It's not just for families here, it's friends as well, because friends are very important. Mm. Can you tell us that side of things?
Yes, I think that friends often get forgotten. And with families now, being so fragmented, living in different parts of the country, sometimes in different countries, friends are very important, and they can often be closer than family. Mm-hmm. And so we do extend our services and counselling to close friends of people with cancer.
So it's the complete circle around the actual cancer sufferer that,
yes,
that are pulled in.
Yes, and people often don't know what to do. They feel very helpless.
Mm.
And they come along to us and say, how can I help? What may be, how can I talk to the children?
Can you teach them the right things to say? Or is that a natural thing and it just has to be natural?
No, it isn't natural, but we hope to make it natural by helping them with their skills, with communication skills. So yes, that is part of it.
Great. We're in the top of the building now, in the multi-purpose room, where group meetings are held, wig fitting, and several other activities. So, Kim, what goes on in this room?
All sorts of things. It's used as a small meeting room. It's also used as my training room for the volunteers, so they come to do their training here.
So their training's ongoing all the time as well, is it?
Yes, we do courses, all sorts of aspects of volunteer listening skills, self-awareness, basic counselling skills. It's also used for our wig fitting service. Rachel Cardy is a hairdresser, a very highly skilled hairdresser, and she started a wig fitting service here, which is very specialised, and again in a really nice homely setting.
So I suppose the wig fitting service, it gives people that confidence back, a little bit of self-esteem back, I suppose.
I think it's really important. It's unique here because we see people before they lose their hair, so that Rachel has a feel for how they looked before they lost their hair, and we get a wig to match exactly if that's what they want.
Yes.
Or they might want to choose a new style.
So they can go blonde or brunette if they want.
If they want to.
And this is for men and women, of course.
Yes, it is.
Yes. Mm. You and I sat on the bed.
We are. Yes, complementary therapies. Palmar reflexologist.
Can you just explain what reflexology is for those that don't know?
Well, I better be careful because I'm not a reflexologist.
Layman's
but what
terms.
She does, yes, it's actually massaging the feet, and the feet relate to certain parts of the body. It's very, very relaxing, and people are highly stressed when they come to see us often, and it's a way of relaxing, unwinding. It's therapeutic as well.
And the bed also is multi-purpose as well, isn't it? It's not just for the reflexology.
That's right. It's fully hydraulic. Again, it was something that was donated to us. It was a great cost, and it's used for reflexology and for aromatherapy.
So what does the future for Jane Skyth House and the society hold?
Well, we hope to expand and develop. I'm sure that's going to happen. In fact, it is happening. We're starting new support groups, bereavement support group, a group for men with cancer, because I think they often find it hard. And bereavement melanoma, ovarian cancer, specialist groups for those people. So there's lots of plans for the
Will
future.
That all take place within this building? Is it important that the premises be in the centre of the community you're serving?
Well, we may have to extend our premises to extend our service, but I'd like to keep Jane Skyth House here, and we may have another building as well. It depends on funds.
And the future for Kim Fielding?
Oh, always to be involved, always to be here, and just to watch it grow and develop.
Thank you very much for your time today, Kim.
Thank you.
So that was Jane Skyth House, which is situated in the 100 at Romsey. The Cancer Care Society really does look after the community. My thanks to Kim and her volunteers for looking after us this morning and showing us around the centre.
Pine is one of nature's faster growing timbers, but it's not just the trees that grow fast, because these days furniture made out of pine has become the fastest growing sector of the market. And today I'm calling in on a thriving Andover-based business who specialise in pine furniture and have become very much a part of its success story during the last couple of years. I want to find out how pine has become top of the pops in furniture. And to help me with that, I'm standing next to the proprietor, David Havers. Good morning, David.
Good morning.
Tell me, how did you become involved in the pine furniture business in the first instance?
Well, I've always been interested in pine furniture, both old and new. And in this growing market, I saw an opportunity to bring something unique to it.
You chose to buy an established business, didn't you, David, rather than actually start from scratch on your own?
Yes, the Pine Factory had been established in Andover for about 7 years, and it provided a good opportunity for me to build on their success.
You've been here since May 1995. How have things progressed since then?
Well, the business has gone from strength to strength, and we've increased the number of suppliers, mm-hmm. and we've provided a much greater choice now for our customers by displaying many more ranges.
And this isn't your only outlet, is it?
No, it isn't. We also opened a new outlet in Thatcham, which has been running successfully for the past 8 months.
Do you have an associated factory as well?
Yes, we decided that this was necessary in order to meet our customer needs of choice, good value and wide range. And with this in mind, Drove Pine was started a year ago here in Andover with my partner Paul Corbishley. Drove Pine is now expanding rapidly and making more and more of our own furniture for both of our shops.
Well, I think it's about time, David, that we braved those elements and went to visit the factory, don't you?
So do I. Come on then.
Let's go. Well, I'm now down at Drove Pine with David and his partner, Paul Corbishley, and you're just about to give me a guided tour and show me how this furniture is actually made, aren't you?
That's right.
So where do we start, David?
Well, we start here with this board of Scandinavian pine. That's how it comes into us.
Okay.
Scandinavian redwood is a high-quality pine, kiln-dried. This is our raw material.
Mm-hmm.
And the first thing that we do is cut it to size on this dimension saw. And the next stage is the spindle moulder, which we use to put all of the edge mouldings onto the furniture, onto the tops and the drawer fronts and the sides. And we use for that different shaped, uniquely shaped tools to give that edge moulding. In this operation, we're using the crosscut saw. We use solid bottoms and solid backs to all of our furniture, and here Paul's cutting the timber to size. Now here we've got the dovetailing machine that we use to make all our drawer boxes with. Once all the machining has been done, we then assemble the furniture on the bench and finish off with sanding it before it goes into the spray shop for staining and lacquering. In the spray shop, Chris is putting the final top coat of lacquer onto a bookcase.
Well, thanks for showing us around the factory, David. It's absolutely fascinating. I just couldn't imagine so much work goes into making a piece of furniture. You see, people tend to think of pine as flat-packed, but it's really nothing like that, is it?
No, that's right. When the market first started to grow, a lot of manufacturers and retailers concentrated just on price, which proved to be really a bit of a mistake, and pine got a name for being a bit down market. We certainly have budget furniture here, but we also go all the way up from there to craftsman-built handmade furniture, like some of these tables and chairs or this dresser you can see. And what they have in common is that whatever you spend and whatever kind of furniture you buy, pine gives you a lot for your money.
So are people more quality-minded these days then?
Oh yes, certainly. They look at how something's put together. They feel the quality and the weight of the wood and how it's finished, which is why we stock such a very wide selection. For instance, 5 different ranges of bedroom furniture. So anyone can find the price or design combination which they want.
What sort of variety of customers are buying pine furniture nowadays?
Oh, enormous variety. Everyone from young couples who want to furnish their home up to people who can really afford to buy anything they want, but like the huge variety of design and the solid feel and quality timber that you can get in pine these days.
New for 1997, here at Andover Leisure Centre, we are introducing a new personal starter pack for all people joining exercise classes over the next 6 weeks. The pack is free and includes a number of complimentary vouchers to attend classes at the Andover Leisure Centre. Remember, whatever your age, whatever your size, and whatever your current fitness level is, we do have something for you. Telephone me, Jackie Morris, on 01264 324 144 for more information.
The Leopard Lounge in London, the launch of the new club there. But first I wanted to try out local club scene, Enzo's. And I'm gonna have a little bop later because I'm feeling still a little bit romantic. Yeah. Hi boys!
Hello!
Hi there!
Hello!
What's your name?
Donald.
And you?
Gavin.
And where are you from?
Ireland.
Ireland, all the way from Ireland, wow.
What about you?
Ireland the same, yes.
So you're not locals?
No. No.
And what about you? What's your name?
Gossy!
Where are you from?
Scunthorpe.
Alright. Okay, I'm just a bit curious about Valentine's night. What have you planned for your loved one?
Oh.
I haven't got any.
Never got a loved one? What about you?
I'm 3 or 4 now, but I can't tell tales.
Alright. Are you not going anywhere special?
Lovely down here.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What? And what about... Are you going to give roses or something like that?
Oh yeah, it will be, yes. Box of chocolates, the whole lot.
Okay, well. Okay, I'm going to see you. What about these two over here? Let's follow them. Hi, girlies.
Hi.
And just where are you from?
I originate from Bristol.
Yeah, what about you?
Evelyn.
What's your name? If you can hear us back here, but I'm very curious about Valentine's Day. What are your plans?
I don't know yet.
You don't have any yet. Oh, we've got a birthday night tonight.
Yeah.
It's your birthday. Well, very happy birthday to you. Excuse me. Sorry to disturb this intimacy here, but I'm sure I spotted some lovers. Am I right?
Yes.
Okay, what's your name?
Chris.
And yours?
Sonia.
Right. Well, I'm very curious about Valentine's Day. What have you planned? Would that be giving away too much?
Well, we're having an early Valentine's weekend because we're both working this week, so we're having it this week. So we booked in for a nice weekend this week.
Have you bought him a little present?
No, not yet.
Secrets. We don't want to be giving away that.
Well, in our quest to find the perfect romantic Valentine's Day spot, we've ended up at the inn at High Post, right. And we're with Enzo. Hello, how are you, Enzo?
Very well, thank you.
Do you mind me calling you Enzo?
Not at all.
Well, no, the night...
Everybody knows me as Enzo.
That's right. Yeah. The nightclub's named after you.
Yes, that was my children's choice.
Yeah. Sasha was just in there actually doing a bit, weren't you? What do you think of that nightclub?
I thought it was great, but I did notice there wasn't very much love in the air. That was
much,
one thing.
Much love. But there's love on your menu, isn't there? Look.
There's a lot of love on my menu.
Come, make in, my, up for the
come in my kitchen, I'll give you lots of love in my menu.
You're always right. A soft one for the Italians, aren't you, Sash?
Si.
With love from Italy. And today they're doing a really special Valentine's Day menu. Out of some Capri.
That's right. What we are trying to do this year will be the first time, really, to introduce something very new in the area, as not been done before. All these starters, they are from the Mediterranean.
So have a look at this.
From the south of Italy, yeah. Which is Capri, as you know, very well known, is the island off the coast of Naples.
Why is Capri romantic?
Very, very romantic.
Why?
Well, it's honeymooners and... And if you remember, many, many years ago, there was a lovely singer that used to be the lover of the soldiers in this country during the war.
Who was that?
I can't remember the name. Tell me.
I think you mean Gracie Fields.
Gracie Fields.
There we go. What a memory.
And she opened a place in Capri, and it's been a romantic
scene.
She
made Capri famous,
that's right.
There was a song, From the Isle of Capri.
Exactly.
There we are, you see.
Absolutely.
So, how about that?
So we got these starters that come from that have been made from the island. Although that the avocado is not grown in Italy, but it still is a part of that setup.
Enzo, speak this to Sasha in Italian, because
Italiano.
I know she just loves Italian.
Qui abbiamo gli antipasti di Capri. Il primo piatto, Sasha, è l'insalata di pomodoro, mozzarella, basilico.
Mozzarella
e basilico, the beautiful basil. Beautiful, absolutely gorgeous. Then you have the avocado con gamberetti.
What's gamberetti?
Gamberetti, the lovely prawns.
Prawns,
the beautiful
gamber, of course, yes, of course.
And a little bit of a touch of garlic. You know, Italian always have a touch of garlic.
You just have to make sure both of you eat that.
Then we have, of course, cozze, mussels. It's the Gulf of Naples. It's full of cozze. And they are done in a beautiful sauce with white wine, tomato, basil, garlic. Excellent, absolutely excellent. And then we have...
Yeah, what about the main courses?
Well, more food.
I happen to know Sasha loves mussels and fish, but...
With the main course, you see, we go to the beautiful breast of chicken done alla veneziana. It's a typical dish that is sauteed with a little bit of onion. People can choose from the full a la carte menu. So this is what we suggest. Mm-hmm. This is what we provide for the actual Valentine's.
Did a lot of people come last year then?
Last year we didn't do anything.
Ah, so this is a new thing.
Exactly. But the bookings are coming on nicely. We have rooms booked for them.
Because it's a great atmosphere. It's very mellow.
We give them a nice accommodation. We give them a good deal. And that's basically... The reason that we're going to...
And it's very warm as well, I have to say that, sitting by the fire.
With your back on it, it's lovely.
So who's going to ask this question? The greatest question.
Tell me.
What makes Italians such special lovers?
Yes, I'm dying to know about this.
It's the warmth of the Mediterranean. I mean, that's pretty...
The warmth of the Mediterranean.
Why the Italians? Why not the Greeks or...
The English. What's wrong with
the English?
What's wrong with the English?
It's a stiff upper lip.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
And we'll see you Wednesday night.
Okay.
And, don't forget to keep on watching Italian TV for more romance in the air.
More romance in the air.
Okay.
Finito.
Bye.
Finito.
Well, I wanted to be romantic tonight. It's Valentine's Day, and who else could I be more romantic with than Alex? Who's just flown in from Hong Kong, haven't you?
Yes, that's right, I have.
So, I've never met anybody before who flies into this country on a Thursday. Actually, she's a friend of Sasha's, this is quite true. She actually flew in on a Thursday, and she's flying out again on Monday?
Monday evening.
I mean, can you imagine coming to this country from Hong Kong for the week?
Very, very fortunate I am.
You're very fortunate?
Yes.
How did you pull that one off?
Well, basically my dad is a pilot. So you see
your dad's a pilot?
I got a free flight over here.
Really?
So I was in the cockpit, takeoff and landing.
Did you fly it?
No, I didn't. I just sort of sat in the background and thought I was a pilot.
Can we give a plug for Cathay Pacific? I suppose we can, can't we?
That's right,
yeah,
yes.
That's right.
And then after the takeoff, you have to go back because it's illegal to sit in the cockpit the whole journey.
Yeah.
So I had to go back in the love seats. And they're basically...
The love seats, romantic, isn't it, you see?
They're basically where the pilots sit when they're tired or something like that. They want a break.
But why are they called love seats?
Because there's a curtain that goes across and you can pull out the centrepiece and just lie across. So it's quite private and quite good.
That's good. What do you do in Hong Kong?
Well, I've just studied Mandarin for 2 years.
Now, I want you to speak some Mandarin into the camera.
Ni hao.
Now, I want you to say something. How about wish...
Some drinks. I could just say
this is a romantic spot on Tandy. We get out a shot. Only joking, Sash.
I'll say something romantic. Okay.
Say something really. I want you. Yeah, tell me what it is first, and then explain to the viewers.
Okay. I'll say. What should I say? You're a very handsome man, and I love you.
That's a bit much, isn't it? Okay.
你很好看，可是我爱你。
That's nice, isn't it?
对.
What's Happy Valentine's Day in Mandarin?
我不知道. I don't know. Or Bridget Dowers, I don't know, because they don't celebrate Valentine's Day in, Valentine's, you'd have to say Valentine Kuai Le.
All right. Okay. Right. We're in the inn at High Post. Yeah. And thanks to Enzo. And have you got a room tonight? No. Only for me, actually, because these two are going back to London. So anyway, don't get excited, viewers. Don't get excited. They're going back to London. I've got to stay here and work with the rest of the crew, Trevor and Ollie on camera. So thanks for watching this great romantic show on Town TV.
It's been fun.
And thanks for coming for the weekend from Hong Kong. I've never met anybody in my life who's actually come from Hong Kong for the weekend.
Very, very lucky.
That's really good. So thank you. Thanks to Sash. Thanks to everybody. And where are we going next? I think we're going to the Leopard Lounge in London.
This is Michael King with a roundup of local news stories from the Andover Advertiser and the Salisbury Journal. Hampshire County Council policymakers have approved a council tax rise of nearly 11% and cuts in services in excess of £13 million. Higher charges for some services, including Meals on Wheels, Home Help and the disposal of commercial waste, have also been recommended by the policymakers in a bid to cover a £14 million budget shortfall. If endorsed by the full council on the 20th of February, the average tax for a bandy home will go up by £49. Bills will increase with charges to be added for services provided by district councils and an anticipated 13% increase in the charge for police services. The latter item alone could add an extra £50 to a bandy property bill. Wide-ranging cuts to be made by all major spending committees will result in residents getting less for the extra money being paid. Less materials and equipment for schools and outdoor activity centres, local community associations, discretionary student grants and some mobile library services. The library book fund is expected to be reduced by almost £950,000, which will result in 100,000 fewer books being made available to readers. On the 17th of February, traffic police launch a week-long seatbelt campaign across the Andover area. Spot checks will be carried out in both town and rural areas. All motorists found driving without wearing their seatbelts face a £20 fine. Canon Tony Wilds, Vicar of St Mary's Andover, is leaving the town during May this year to take up a new appointment in Solihull. Canon Wilds admits to great enjoyment during his 11 years in Andover and feels that the church, the community and the various official bodies all seem to work together very well. The new managers of Andover's Chantry Centre are optimistic that well-known names in retailing could soon open up in the Mall. Patrick Hill, who has moved to Andover from Norfolk, revealed that a great many inquiries have been received on lettings in the Chantry Centre, and with office manager Beverly Streets, confesses to having lots of ideas to make the centre buzz for the community. According to a recent police survey, the vast majority of people living in the Andover area feel safe from crime. Around 67% of men and 57% of women say that they are very safe in their homes at night, with under 10% feeling either fairly or very unsafe. Some 96% of those questioned believe that their neighbourhood was fairly or very safe to live in. The police, for whom the telephone survey was carried out during December 1996, involving 129 residents, say the results are a valid representation of local opinion. Nearly one-third of those questioned had no concern over areas in which the police should be concentrating, and most popular worries amongst the remainder were speeding, burglaries, vandalism, youths congregating and drug dealing. Public opinion was split over the adequacy of the level of police presence. Inspector Dave Waller from Andover Police says that the results reflected that crime in this area is not a vast problem. The results will be used by the Andover Police Subdivision when producing their service plan for 1997-98. Salisbury News. Workers from the 600 NAFI staff facing redundancy in Amesbury spoke of their anger and sense of devastation this week and predicted a calamity would hit the town. They were left dumbstruck and shattered by the news that the £400 million contract to supply food to the forces had been awarded to another company. Many workers said they were too old to get other jobs and feared they would lose their homes. the job losses begin in July. Homeowners worried about the effect of prices on their properties because of the proposed Salisbury bypass were amongst hundreds of people who attended last week's exhibition in Salisbury, which set out Wiltshire County and Salisbury District Council's transport plans for the city. The three-day event in the Maltings detailed the council's strategy for reducing the use of the private car and encouraging people to switch to public transport. Topics included proposed road improvements, park and ride, cycling and walking facilities, parking and traffic management. Also on motoring issues, a plea by Salisbury Mayor Beryl Jay for a rethink over a planned hike in parking charges has been rejected. The mayor stated that she realised that extra revenue needed to be raised, but the increases were very sad and will hit a lot of people's pockets. Council leader John Hayward told her the increased charges would bring in the £180,000 needed to balance the budget after a £448,000 cut in government supply. Salisbury teenagers got a boost this week when the Lottery Sports Fund announced a £27,950 grant towards the District Council's plan to set up a street sports complex. The council aims to site the complex, which will include a ramp system for skate and snakeboarding and a rink for street hockey in Churchill Gardens, at a total cost of nearly £40,000. Parks manager Reg Williams was absolutely delighted with the award. Also scheduled for Churchill Gardens is a £45,000 revamp for the toilets. Sited in the car park opposite the college, they will have a disabled section added, plus changing facilities in both the ladies' and the gents' sides. Portable toilets will be set up as a temporary measure while the improvement work, which is expected to last 6 weeks, is carried out. And finally, a thought to console you if you were let down on Valentine's Day. Look forward to May, when Fishton Mill is staging an exhibition named Love, Love, Love. You may not find a lover, but you will be able to celebrate love in photography, paintings, textiles and more at the Salisbury Design and Craft Emporium starting on May the 1st. As Reg Presley says, love is all around. So on behalf of the entire Town TV team, I would like to wish you a very romantic week. That concludes a roundup of the reports brought to you by Michael King.
Welcome back to the love-in studio, I guess you're going to say.
Yeah, because it's Valentine's Week, isn't it?
It's Valentine's Week here on Town TV, and for you people out there, lots of love from us lot.
Yes, indeed, to everybody.
Yeah. Even in Mike, the newsreader, sent all that sort of love and slushy stuff.
Oh, no.
All over Hampshire and Wiltshire. Me, I've been up in Oxford this week, rushing around there.
Yeah, you've been busy up there.
Filming the launch of the local radio station up there. That's been chaotic. Steve has been a hero. Steve's on camera today. Haven't you, Steve?
Steve, speak to me.
Yep.
See, he is there, folks.
He's been working like mad all week.
Yeah, he's been a hero. I think Steve's in love as well.
Is he?
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, with Madonna.
Well, yes. not that interview again.
What else is happening? I guess we've been all to these nightclubs. We went to the Leopard Lounge in London. We went to Enzo's, didn't we?
Mm.
Went everywhere.
Everywhere.
He went to bed.
I did.
Look,
it's too late for me.
You're doing going to bed. This man's a rock and roller. He got a Valentine card this morning, didn't you?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Wild thing, I think I love you.
That's what was on it.
Right. Anyway, enough of all this love stuff. Let's get on with this draw. What was the prize?
A day for two.
A day for two.
At Coombe, what's Castle Coombe?
Castle Coombe Motor Racing Circuit. Yeah.
That's with great. Food and drinks.
With food and drinks and all that sort of stuff. Thousands of entries for this one. And, of course, the answer was Graham Hill was the father of, not Damien, but Damon Hill. Who's won this? It's an Andover number, and I think the lady works at Tandy's, I'm not sure. Gilly Heath.
Gilly Heath.
There we are, you've won that lovely, that's a romantic day out for two.
It is,
Castle
smashing
Coombe.
Day out there.
Well done, Gilly Heath, you've won that. And for this week, we're going to continue the love theme and all that sort of stuff.
We're having too much of this.
Too much love on Town TV. We're going to continue with this question. Well, it's a musical question, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
What was the name of the group, a very, very famous rock band, who actually sang All You Need Is Love? Do you know that one?
Great song.
Go on, sing it then.
I will not.
I don't want to sing in front of it. If you turn the lights out, I might.
All you need is love.
It was on the first world.
Put the light.
Turning the lights out.
No, Steve. Steve.
All right, sorry.
Okay. Let's go onto his head.
Right, that song was sung on the first worldwide transmission.
It was, wasn't it? Yeah. There's four guys in the band, and all you need is love. Ring us if you know the answer to that, and you will get a wonderful romantic meal for two at the George Inn at St. Marybone. That's a fabulous restaurant.
It is great. George Inn. Food is excellent.
Candles and wine, and they do oysters as well.
Oh,
I love oysters. You may not love oysters, but I love them.
So,
so who sang All You Need Is Love? And ring us now on Andover 390 or Salisbury 555 222, or fax us on Andover 390 391, or write to us at PO Box 555 in Andover. So there we are. I hope you've enjoyed our love-in this week. Going over the top now, isn't it?
Yes, really? It is a bit.
But with all that doom and gloom out there, you need a bit of happiness.
You need a bit of happiness and love
sort of
and
yeah, so sort of stuff. Well done, Julie Heath. And now we're going to probably the nightclub in Salisbury. Sasha's over there with Alex leaping round.
Yeah.
And there we go. Love is in the air at Churchill's nightclub in Salisbury. So see you next week. I hope you enjoyed the mad show this week. So take care. Write to us. Ring us. Do whatever you want to do, but just make contact. Bye for now.
Bye.
We're just about to attack Churchill's, the biggest nightclub in Salisbury.
Hey, it's cool. What are you thinking?
Cool.
Alex, are you excited?
Very.
Hong Kong for the weekend, you come to Churchill's in Salisbury.
Music sounds damn good.
Here we go, let's go in. Try and find the bar. Sash, try and find the bar. It's this way, this way. This way. Come on, let's go and get a drink. Let's try and find the bar.
Go. Churchill's, I hope you can hear me. I'm going to go and find these two over here. Hello there.
Hiya.
What's your name?
I'm Paul.
Where are you from?
I'm from Salisbury.
And what about your friends?
Hi.
What's your name?
My name's Pete.
Are you from here as well?
Near enough, yeah. What's your name?
My name's Sasha.
Where are you from?
From London. So what about Valentine's night? Have you got any plans?
Maybe.
Live in the air?
I got a party. You'll have to see what comes through your letterbox.
I'm just pretending it's a heaven and hell. Back for Salisbury.